Good morning, everyone. The first session itself is on developing learning objective. So learning objectives, what is learning objective, why we want to create learning objective, and how to create learning objective. These are the sessions conducted here. So I'm Madhuri Marvin Kurve, faculty from Thakur College of Engineering and research scholar at Education Technology. Along with my guide Sahana Murthy, we are conducting the sessions on development of learning objective. After completion of this session, what we expect you to do is, you will able to explain what is learning objective or need for learning objective. You can identify what is valid learning objective, and you will able to write learning objective for the course what you are taking for the next semester. So now, as a teacher, what we expect student to learn? Definitely first is the content, that is the course, whichever course you are teaching, whatever is the important concept, whatever the important concept applications, all these things you feel that student should able to learn through your courses. But along with the content, what we expect is some skills should be developed in the student, or some abilities should be developed in the student. Now these abilities can be complex problem solving abilities, maybe designing of the experiment, maybe making some predictions, or how to check solutions. So these are certain abilities we expect student to do once they study the course. And the third point is attitude. What is all engineering about? If there is an open problem, how to attain that problem? So these are all attitudes student need to develop after learning the course. So these are, as a teacher, these are our expectations. So now imagine a teaching learning scenario. The course is digital logic design. Topic is VHDL. It is a simulation language for digital circuit design, and students are from second year engineering, electronics engineering. Now this is just a brief refresher on the digital logic design or digital logic circuit. What it contains basically, digital logic circuit is an electronic device wherein decision, logical decisions are made by the device depending upon different digital input signal which are given at the input. Now for example, this is the NOT gate where the symbol is shown here. Now what NOT gate does is, it just inverses the input signal. That is, if you give a positive signal, you will get a negative signal from the gate. So such three basic types of gates are in a digital logic circuit. So this is a very basic introduction of the logic circuit. This is just a refresher for all those they know what is a logic circuit, and those they are not knowing what is the logic circuit as a course. Now this logic gates, they can be tested using a signal practically. That is, hardware is possible, you mount it, you test it. The second method is you can test it even using a simulation language. That is, you can simulate that gate, apply different signals through test bench and see what is the output. Now in order to do this, there is a simulation software which is available, that is known as VHDL. VHDL is very high speed hardware description language, wherein you are describing that logic circuit, you apply different signals and you test the signal. So now let us come back to the teaching learning scenario. Now teaching learning scenario is, this is this VHDL is the part of a digital logic system which is taught by a teacher. Now when teacher is teaching the subject, it is being a small unit. What is done by teacher is, teacher explain all instruction set of VHDL in the class, explain all the commands with example, and wrote few programs for standard circuit. So this is what is done by teacher. Now let us see what student had done. So students studied whatever is taught, whatever commands are taught to them in VHDL. Whatever problems solved by teacher in the classroom, they practice same problems at home. Now let us see what happened in exam. Now this is the exam question. Exam question is related to some real life scenario. Switches are given and on off conditions are given to the student, and they are supposed to simulate the situation using VHDL. So what is expected from student here? They are supposed to analyze that situation, convert that situation into logic gate, and then use VHDL program and implement VHDL program. This is what is a simple expectation from the exam. Now let us see what happened. Result is, most of the students were not able to attempt this question or solve this question. So now let us see what is wrong. So when feedback is taken, student clear cut said that this question is out of syllabus because they have not solved it, they have not come across any real life situation, they have solved problems with very standard gates, and VHDL being very small part of the entire syllabus, teacher treated in the way it is given in the syllabus. So now instructor comment is, see, this question is very simple, they have to just apply logic and they have to solve the problem, VHDL commands are known to them. So now this is what is the teaching learning scenario. Most of the time as a teacher we also come across this situation. We know that the questions are simple, but students feel that they are out of syllabus. So let us do this as activity. According to us, as a teacher we are right, according to students, students are also right, but something is wrong. So let us find out what is wrong.
Okay, so as you heard just now, what was presented is a scenario in which the teacher teaches the concepts of a certain topic. Students also go and study the same concepts, and what was given in the exam was a simple real life application of those concepts, and you saw what happened in the exam and the poor result. So what we'd like you to do is to try to pinpoint a little precisely what exactly went wrong, because we know here that both the teacher and the student's comment, both are valid, both are right in their own regard, but still there is something that did not work because the exam results were really poor. So what we'd like you to do here is an activity in the format of what's called think, pair, share. So this activity has three phases. In the first phase, the think phase, what each of you need to do is come up with one possible reason as to what went wrong and write it in your notebook. So there's 2 minutes for this phase. Write it in your notebook. There's nothing to be done on AVU or so yet. As soon as the 2 minutes are over, we'll put up the instructions for the next phase. So let the think phase start right now. Write what went wrong in your notebook. No discussion at this point. We'll give you opportunity for discussion in 2 minutes exactly. So this has to be done as an individual activity. Please write the answer in your notebooks. Coordinators, please just see that everybody is writing the answer to this question in their notebooks. I'd like to remind all of you that there is no single correct answer in this question. So because of that, what you next need to do is to turn to your neighbor. So this is the pair phase of the activity, where you turn to your neighbor and discuss your reason with your neighbor, and the neighbor will do the same. So share your reasons with each other. This is the phase where you can actually talk to your neighbor and together come up with which is a stronger reason. So since there may be multiple valid answers, this is a good time to find out what other possible answers are and collectively see what is really happening in this scenario. So let's take about 4 or 5 minutes for this phase. Those of you who are sitting far away from other people, please get up and move towards somebody else. Most of the activities in this session will occur, in most of the activities you'll have to talk to somebody, work with a group and so on. So and the other thing is, instead of only two people, if three of you want to talk together, that's also fine. So if you're sitting alone, like we can see in your video in some colleges, just feel free to get up and move to a place where there are other people with whom you can discuss. So here's a reminder of the expectations that we set about half an hour ago. You discuss with each other on task. You'll get most out of the sessions if you do discuss what you're supposed to discuss at this time. See, we can see your videos, so we know what you're doing. All right, so if you've discussed the answer with your neighbor, now let's move to the third phase, where together as a center or as a class, you come up with a really strong reason, share your answers with the other people in the class. And the way we'll do this phase is that each pair can share your strong reason with the remote center coordinator and with the other participants. So you can speak up. There'll be a so this is a short open discussion session within each remote center. Coordinators, your role right now is to moderate the discussion first. So let a few pairs or all pairs, if you have a few people, share their reasons. And then your role, your responsibility is to share the top two reasons from your center via the AU chat. So let your participants tell you, let the pairs tell you what they came up with. And you can pick the two most frequent ones or the two strongest ones and share it on the chat window. And finally, we'll summarize the answers from all the different centers once we take over again. So you can spend about 5 minutes doing a discussion, a moderation within your center, and then you can share it. I hope all coordinators are present in the classrooms to moderate the discussion. So we see that in a few centers like Tyagarajar College, the share phase discussion is going on in a very animated and committed fashion. So this, what the coordinator there is doing really well is in fact taking down notes so that he can later convey to us. So good job. Some of you still seem to be doing the pair phase activity. I'd like to encourage all of you to move to the third phase where you discuss as an entire class moderated by the coordinator. When you think of the reason, please think of why the problem exists. This is not to blame either the student or the teacher. It's not that either of them is doing anything wrong, because the title of the slide, as you said, is that both are right. The teacher feels that the topic was taught and the student feels that, well, they did not learn the topic. So why is there this problem? There is no blame to be associated in this case. All right, so many of you have shared your reasons here. Let me read out some and then we'll summarize, we'll try to put all of it together. Okay, so some reasons that have come up here are that not sufficient hands-on experience has been provided to the students. Another college is saying that more applications, more real-life problems need to be discussed in class to show how it connects to the concepts discussed. Here is an important reason that's coming up, that if we teach the logic behind the problem and then do the problem, then students can actually apply it to other problems. One of you is saying that students are not motivated enough to solve the problems. All these reasons actually make sense. We'll see that there's actually a common reason behind all these problems. Let's try to find a couple of more reasons and then we'll summarize. All right, here is one. That the faculty are also not able to understand the exact outcome expected from the students. So if we put all of it together, if we summarize it, what we can say as to what went wrong in the teaching learning scenario. So now we are moving to the next part of this session. Let's summarize the activity. That the teacher and the exam setters had some expectations. And the students had their own expectations and they have their own level of learning. And there is some mismatch between the two. So what we did so far in this activity is that we wanted to try to get this point, try to come to the point of a mismatch between the two. In the next slide, we'll try to see how to solve this mismatch. And the way we ran this activity, now I'd like all of you to think from a teacher's perspective for a few minutes. There was an open question as to what was wrong with the scenario, and we wanted all the participants to discuss answers to this question. Typically, what we would do in a traditional classroom is simply ask the question and one or two people would raise their hand and say, okay, here is an answer. But when we do that, the class is not participatory enough, and I think one of you has even written that in your reasons. So to get all students to be engaged in a certain activity, in a certain teaching learning activity, and to get a highly participatory class, there is a method called think pair share. That's the one we just did, wherein we split the activity into three phases, exactly like the way we did. In the first phase, each participant or each student has to write an answer. In the second phase, they discuss with a neighbor. And in the third phase, they come together as a class and do it. So splitting it and staggering the activity into these three phases ensures that everybody is committed, everybody's answer gets heard, and everybody has a way to listen to each other's answers also. So we'll come back to this technique several times in these sessions over these 3 days. Okay, so let me hand the mic back to Madhuri, and she'll now discuss some possible solutions for this mismatch.
So now, we have seen that there is a mismatch between teacher or examiner's expectation and what is the student level of learning. So we need to match this. And how can we match this? So in order to match this, the solution is I have to clearly spell as a teacher what are my goals as a teacher. What I want my students to take away when I complete a class. So keeping these goals and objectives in mind, we define learning objectives, wherein learning objectives will give clear idea what is my expectation as a teacher and where students will fall in this expectation or how I will train student to that level. So I need to define learning objectives. So let us see the definition of learning objective. Learning objectives are basically goal statements which includes specific, measurable performance outcome of the learner. So we have to underline this word, specific, measurable performance outcome of the learner. Now let us recall the same digital logic circuit. These are the gates which are decision making devices, and I already gave an example of NOT gate. So what is a learning objective for this topic? So if I want to define learning objective for basic gate, I will define it as students will be able to write truth table of a NOT gate. This can be one of the learning objective. The second learning objective can be students will be able to write code for in VHDL for a NOT gate. So these are some examples of learning gate. So here specific measurable performance I am taking. So when I define learning objective, what I am measuring here specifically is they will able to write a truth table. So simple expectation is here, or simple specific measurable outcome is, if they write a truth table for NOT gate, that is a measurable outcome and student should able to do it. So accordingly I will teach them in the classroom. In second case, they will able to write VHDL code. So here what all things are expected, they should know what is NOT gate, what is a truth table, so this is a measurable performance, and then they should able to convert it into code. So this is also another measurable performance for a given learning objective. So here measurable performance is they will able to write a code for the NOT gate. So this is very specific and it is measurable as well.
One more thing that you can notice is each of these learning objectives starts with students will be able to do something. Students will be able to write. Students will write a truth table, or students will be able to write a code. And why we start it like that is, if you go back to the definition, the learning objective has to have or has to say what is the performance outcome of learner. And what performance outcome means is it should say what the student should be able to do. So performance is something that is demonstrable, something that the student actually can do. So along with specific and measurable, a learning objective is written in such a way that you have to think about what exactly the student can do or what student should do after the teaching. That's why all learning objectives start with the phrase students will be able to write the truth table. So now you have seen this definition. I think it's worthwhile copying this definition into your notebook for a moment, because the next activity which we have actually is an application of this definition. In the previous activity we saw that giving concepts and definition is not sufficient, and immediately a teacher has to do some examples where it's applied. So now right now we are the teachers, so what we'll do is take this definition and we'll pose an activity based on this definition. So I'll pause on this slide for about 30 seconds. Write down this and then I'll pose the activity. Okay, so let's go to the activity. Here the activity is of a slightly different format than the previous think, pair, share activity, and this will actually be a polling or a voting type of activity. So what we will do here is in the next slide, or in actually the polling feature of AVU, I'll pose a multiple choice question and five choices for the question. So what you need to do as participants, in fact right away, you need to discuss with a neighbor. And then you need to vote in your own class by raising your fingers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whichever you think is the right answer. So discuss with your neighbor, converge on an answer with your neighbor. So if you and your neighbor have different choices, keep talking to them till you converge. And once you converge, you can raise your fingers and you can in fact tell the coordinator what your choice is. Once you do that, what the coordinator will do is share the majority choice through AVU poll. So I'll start the poll in a moment. I'll first pose the questions and then I'll start the poll. So is everybody ready? I hope everybody is ready. Here are the questions. So just right now, just read it and in a moment I'll start the poll. Different learning objectives are given and what you need to do is say which of these are valid, appropriate learning objectives based on the definition that you just wrote down in your notebooks. Discuss the answer with your neighbor and you can raise your hand within your center. So what the center coordinator needs to do at this point is to make a rough note of how many of the participants say 1, how many say 2, how many say 4 and so on. You don't need to do anything on chat right now. We'll start the poll in about 2 minutes. So do a local poll at this point. So I'm going to start the polling in AVU, in the AVU poll feature. What the coordinators can do actually is to, in the poll feature, you can post the answer to the same question. We'll wait for another 30 seconds or so. I think about 20 centers, 25 centers have done it so far. Let's just wait for all the centers to do it. Okay, great. So looks like most of you have actually polled. And let me tell you the results. Okay, it looks like, let me just read out the results that I have. It looks like about in 23 centers, the majority say that all these objectives are valid. In about 10 centers, the results are that either the first one is valid, where students understand the function of logic gates, or the third one is valid, where students know how logic gates work. And there's very few who say none of the above. And maybe one person has chosen the other one. So the majority of people think that all these three are valid learning objectives. So now let's see what the answer really is. It turns out that, as you see the answer, none of these are valid learning objectives. So I'll let Madhuri explain why this is so.
So what we have seen is, whatever written right now here, all the three, that is, they are not valid learning objective. Why they are not valid learning objective? Let us visit to the definition of learning objective. What definition says? Learning objective includes specific, measurable performance outcome of the students. So now, let us see one by one, all these learning objectives. The first learning objective is students will be able to understand function of the logic gate. So now when we say that understand function of the logic gate, it is not a specific measurable outcome. Understanding of function, how are we going to check it? If they are able to draw the circuit is also understanding. If they are able to write truth table is also understanding. So what is a specific measurable outcome when we say that? Student will be able to understand the function. So when, let us go to the second learning objective. Student will be able to visualize logic gate. Now visualization of logic gate, it's difficult to measure. It can be in the form of waveform, it can be in the form of truth table. So how are we going to measure visualization of logic gate of the students? The third is they will know. So how you know that students are knowing logic gate, how logic gate works? How are you going to measure that student know how logic gate works? So for all these three verbs, whatever we have used, none of them are specific measurable performance outcome of the student. And definition says that we want specific measurable outcome of the student, which is not fulfilled by any one of this, and thus none of the above is the answer for this question, that is, none of the learning objective written here satisfies definition of learning objective.
This is really an important slide here, so that's why I'd like to keep this on for a moment. And Madhuri explained why each of these is not a valid learning objective. What I'd like you to think about as teachers is, if you want to try to measure students' understanding, there are various ways in which you might think understanding can be measured. Some of you might ask students to simply define the quantity. Some of you might ask students to give an example to measure understanding. Others might ask students to draw something to measure understanding. Yet others might give an application problem or a real life problem to measure understanding. So understand actually can stand for a variety of different things. And this is exactly where the mismatch happens, as you saw in the teaching learning scenario. That the teacher, according to the teacher, understanding meant solving a real life problem. But according to the students, understanding simply meant knowing the concepts or writing the definition of the concepts. So, as a teacher, this word understand is really problematic. It's not at all precise. So, what we'll do now is to see how exactly to write learning objectives so that they are specific and measurable. And the other point which you should note here is that none of these are really performance outcomes in the sense, what is it that you want the student to specifically be able to do? You're not trying to find out what's in the student's mind, but you're looking for actions and behaviors of the student. That's what's meant by performance outcome.
So now let us see how to construct learning objectives. Now as a teacher, we always start with syllabus. So I've selected one particular topic from the syllabus, that is logic gates. Now I've just elaborated what is the content in that particular topic. So, logic gate contains basic gates, their functions and truth tables. Then there are some logic expressions, logic diagrams, combination of these logic diagrams and universal gates. So, this is the content of the syllabus. So, this is always available with us in the syllabus format. So, now from the syllabus onwards, what is to be defined first? So, we have to define first what are possible measurable outcomes for a given topic. So, I have defined few of them, that student will be able to draw symbols of the basic gate. So, that can be one of the specific measurable performance outcome, that is they will draw symbol that is only expected from students, or they will just able to write a truth table if symbol is given to them or gate is mentioned to them, they will able to write simply a truth table. Then third can be, if a circuit is given to them, they can able to show a logic diagram, connection diagram, or if any practical problem is given to them, they will able to convert it into simple logical expression. So here what we are expecting is, what is the performance outcome, that is measurable performance outcome. So drawing of the symbol you can measure easily. If they write a truth table, that is also measurable performance. If they draw a diagram, you can look at the diagram, you can see the details of the diagram, and the diagram itself is a measurable outcome. Or if they write some logic expression, that is also a measurable outcome. So first we need to identify what are measurable performance outcome for a given topic. There can be many outcomes, there can be few outcomes, it's up to teacher that what level you are expecting from the students. So accordingly, we have to define first measurable performance outcome. So this is how it is defined, and then simply convert them into learning objective. Now when we write learning objective, as mentioned by Sana ma'am, you have to write it student oriented. So what student will be able to do? So when I write a learning objective, it should be student will be able to draw symbol of given basic gate. So it is student center or learner center, and measurable performance outcome. So, all the possible measurable outcomes are now converted to learning objective as student will be able to write truth table for a basic gate, student will be able to draw logic diagram, student will be able to draw symbol for a given basic gate. So, these are the learning objective. So, what, how we started? We started with a simple topic from the syllabus. We noted down or we have listed what are possible performance outcome for a given topic or given module, and then we converted them into learning objectives. So, what is important in construction of learning objective is you have to select an appropriate action verb. That action verb should able to say what is the performance outcome of a student. It should be specific, measurable outcome. So, when we are writing learning objective, you have to remember that we are not supposed to use this verbs, that is understand function of logic gates, visualize logic circuits. They will know how logic circuits or logic gates work. Instead, what we have to use? Action verbs like identify, list, student will able to describe logic diagram, student will able to explain function of logic gate, they will able to solve problem. So, there should be specific measurable learning outcomes of a student. So, verbs, whatever verbs you are using, that verb should actually predict or give action or the performance measures of the student. That is most important when we are writing learning objectives. Similarly, we should not say that I will teach logic circuits with examples, I will show animation, because we say that learning objectives are mainly student oriented.
Let's do a quick activity here. And in the previous slide, we saw that teach logic circuits with examples, show animation, etc. are not valid learning objectives. So, can you just quickly discuss with your neighbor and try to come up with a reason for why these are not valid learning objectives? We won't do a formal think pair share here, but write a possible reason with your neighbor and then we'll post the answer and you can do a self-assessment. So, about a minute or so for this activity. This is like the pair phase of the think, pair, share activity. So, discuss the answer with your neighbor. Okay, so as some of you I think have an idea, you should think about who is going to be doing the teaching or who is going to be doing the showing of the animation. If you recall the definition of the learning objectives that you wrote in your notebooks, they should talk about the performance outcome of the learner. So, each learning objective has to be written from the perspective of the learner. It's not what the teacher will do. What is written here, in fact, is correct in the sense the teacher has to plan her lecture or his lecture in terms of what they will teach, what they will show, and so on. So, these come under instructional goals or teacher's lesson plan and so on. But these are not what we mean as learning objectives. So, each learning objective, instead of being concerned with the teacher, they should be concerned with the learner. So, let's just summarize the two important rules for writing learning objectives. The first rule is that use specific action verbs such as the ones given in the list. Identify, list, describe, explain, solve, analyze, and so on. In fact, it might be worthwhile to copy this list down at this point, because very soon you'll be writing your own learning objectives. And the second thing you can do is to start the sentence with the student will be able to. The moment you start the sentence with the student will be able to do something, then automatically the learning objective will be concerned with the learner and not necessarily with the teacher. Right? So, these are the two rules for writing learning objectives. Alright, so here is a big activity that you can do now in your centers. So, each participant, please pair up with a partner, and preferably pair up with a partner who's in the same subject domain, who will be teaching the same course, not the same course, but who's in the same department as you. That will make it easier for you to do this activity. So you can get up, change seats, and find a partner who's in the same department or who might be familiar with the same domain as you. Then together, you select the course that you will be teaching this semester, or any one course. Select a specific topic in your syllabus. So for example, the example we gave, we took the course or the subject of digital logic circuit design, and we specifically looked at gates and truth table. So choose a narrow topic. After you've done all these, your task is to write 2 learning objectives for that specific topic. So if you have any questions, you can actually ask questions about this activity. You can ask it on chat. Let's spend about 7 or 8 minutes on this activity. Let me do a quick interruption at this point. So it looks like many of you are in fact discussing with each other and writing your learning objectives. So what we'll do as a very small activity now is we'll give you a couple of hints so that you can self-assess your work and see whether your learning objectives are valid or not. So participants, check if you started your learning objective with "the student should be able to." Secondly, did you use action verbs, the ones that was there on one of the previous slides? And as you saw in the polling question, you should avoid the words "understand," "know." Some other words to avoid are "appreciate," or "visualize," and especially "understand" or "know." So let's take a break now. Do the self-assessment, and over tea, keep talking with your neighbor about this, and rewrite your learning objectives if one of these two was not present. So when you come back at 11:30, what you will do is share your objectives with your coordinator as soon as you write the correct ones. And the coordinator can collect a few learning objectives from the participants and share on AVU. So right now, I'll put up the slide for self-assessment. Do the self-assessment, and if your objectives fail this assessment, rewrite your learning objectives. So that's your task for the next half an hour. Okay, so hope all of you have assembled back. And we see that from some colleges, you have sent some of the learning objectives that the participants have written. So if you have not done so, this would be a good time to send over chat what learning objectives the participants in your RC came up with. Before sending it, run it through the self-assessment 2 points that is on the slide, that it should start with "students should be able to," and it should contain some action verb. And in a couple of minutes, what we'll do is discuss some of these and look at the valid ones, look at the not valid ones, try to see if there is something more we can talk in terms of learning objectives and so on. Okay, so it looks like most of you have got the hang of writing learning objectives the way they're supposed to be written. So let me read a few, and if I have any comments, we'll do that so that everybody else can also benefit. So I'm just picking some from the chat that came up. So these are all from different subjects. Students should be able to draw the growth curve. There are several of these. Students should be able to draw the different phases of some cycle. Students should be able to represent the different steps of the process. So anytime you want students to be able to draw, represent using diagrams, it's a very useful learning objective to have, because before you can do any sort of analysis, this sort of representation is required. So when you're trying to plan your lessons and thinking of learning objectives, there may be a few for which draw, represent is in fact a very valid learning objective. A few more. Student will be able to identify various types of data. Students will be able to list all the data types available in C. Students will be able to identify the steps of convolution. students will be able to identify the stacks in real life. Let's look at this last one. Students will be able to identify stacks in real life. This has to be written maybe a little more precisely. Identify examples in real life where stacks are applicable or something like that. So again, when I read it, you'll see that there are categories of learning objectives. A lot of them are about listing types of certain, some kind of object, or identifying where that object occurs in a given situation and so on. So now as I'm reading these learning objectives, what I'd like you to think about is where in the topic these learning objectives are important. In the sense, will you think about these learning objectives in the beginning of your instruction, sometime in the middle of the topic, or towards the end of the topic? Because the next topic we want to explore in learning objectives, and we'll do it over the next 3 days, is not simply write them, but also order these. And finally, we need to be able to write exam questions which are aligned to these learning objectives. The problem that we saw earlier was a mismatch between the teacher's expectations and the student's results. So in order to bridge this mismatch, we need an alignment between the objectives and the exam questions. And before we are able to do this alignment, we have to try to imagine where these objectives actually fit. Okay, so I think this would be a good time to stop sending the learning objectives. Let me categorize a few more. Let me see, in fact, most of these are written in a valid manner. So I'll see if there is anything that's not valid and comment upon it. So we saw a category of representing and a category of identifying or listing. So here is a slightly different category where it says that students should be able to convert from one coordinate system to another. Students should be able to analyze the circuit and solve for the currents in the different branches. Students should be able to calculate the output of the different configurations. I'm not saying which subject these are in, but it should be applicable to a number of different subjects. Students should be able to analyze the problem in terms of graphs. So you see, now we are talking of objectives where students calculate something, for example, current, or they analyze the different branches in the graph, and we've moved to a different level, different type of objective than simply listing different categories. So we had a number of objectives in the listing and identifying category. We had some in the representation category. Now we are looking at those in the calculate, solve, applying. So these are objectives where the student has to apply concepts to solve some problem. And then there is another category of objectives from what you have written, where it says that students should be able to create a solid model of a joint. Students should be able to design a circuit for an amplifier. Students should be able to design parts of the engine. So the moment we get into create and design, we are going even beyond routine problem solving. So from these categories of objectives, what I'd like you to think about is some sort of order. And in tomorrow's session, what we'll do is we'll look into the sequencing and ordering of learning objectives, and we'll look at a formal way of trying to classify these objectives. So in the next 5 minutes, what you can do with your own learning objectives, you just do it as a pair activity, is say whether you will, the objectives that you've written already, write down whether you'll use those objectives in the first class of that topic, or in the middle classes of that topic, or in the later classes of the topic. So I'm assuming that a topic is taught for, say, three or four classes. So are your objectives better suited for the initial part, the middle part, or the latter part of that topic? So just make a note in your objective, and we'll use these objectives later tomorrow. So do spend a couple of minutes on it. I don't think we need to discuss it, but just make a note of it. You can debate this with your neighbor. When should I teach using this objective?
So coming back to the summary of what we learned today, we have put all the things together. We learned how to write learning objective, considering what are the specific measurable outcome from the given topic. So in order to summarize how these learning objectives are fitting, the same topic I am continuing with, that is the logic gates basics. First I will define all these learning objectives, that is student will able to draw symbol of logic gates, student will be able to draw logic diagram for given mathematical expression, student will identify gate combination for a given real life problem. So with this three, that is as just now the exercise was given to you to categorize, first two may be my first learning objective for first two or three classes, and the last one I will put as the last for the last class of the particular topic. So this is how I will categorize, and then accordingly I will plan my instructions, that is in order to fulfill this learning objective what all I should do in the class. So my lecture plan will be, I will explain them gates with symbols, with truth table. I will make them practice these things or remember these things, recall these things. Then I will show them real life situation, some problems I will solve, because that is one of the learning objective for me. Similarly, I will draw logic diagram in the classroom. I will tell them to identify mathematical expression. Few problems I will solve, few problems I will them to solve. This is how I will make them practice, and this is what my entire lesson plan. So you can see that if I plan my learning objectives in advance, accordingly I will plan each one of my lecture, accordingly I will add on activities in my lecture, and my each lecture will be definitely aligned to fulfill this learning objective. So this is why we need to define learning objectives, so that our instructional plan will be foolproof. Then once I follow this instruction plan, students also will have same study plan, because whatever you do in the classroom, whatever instructions you give in the classroom, accordingly they will practice these symbols, they will solve problem, they will take up problems from real life, they will try to write the gates, they will try to find practice some logic diagram problems using mathematical expressions, so on and so forth. Because I have given them a clear cut instructional plan, I taught all these things in the classroom, the same plan will be followed by students as well. So this is how we are avoiding mismatch between instructor and student, that is instructor's expectation and student level of learning will be matched. Now once I define learning objective, and then the third part is the exam. So once the learning objectives are very clear, the exam questions will be also based on learning objectives, because now we are telling that these are the performance outcomes expected from students, so we need to test them for this performance outcome only. So accordingly the exam questions will be there. So this is how learning objective will align your instructor plan, student plan, study plan and exam as well. So what LOE is doing finally, the learning objective is combining teaching plan, student learning and student assessment as well, and this is how we can avoid mismatch between teacher's expectation and student's learning level, and we can maintain uniformity across the plans of all the teachers over the university. And similarly the assessment also, or the question assessment questions also will be based on whatever is taught in the classroom.
Okay, so what this slide is saying is the three different parts which are needed for effective teaching and effective learning, which is really our primary goal. So what we'll do now is two things, and both these activities will be, you will need to do in the computer lab. So far all of you have written learning objectives, most of them are okay. We still see one or two which say students are able to understand how the antenna works. Again, remember the word understand, it's not wrong, but it's not very useful since it's not precise. And the moment you say students will be able to understand antenna, there will be a mismatch between what you expect and what the student thinks he or she should do. So do avoid the word understand and instead use the words from the list of action verbs. So now that you've written two learning objectives and have also thought about where in your instructional sequence you will plan activities for these objectives, we have to look at the third part, which is the assessment part. We have created a mini assignment on Moodle where you can upload your two objectives, and the new part is you need to write one assessment question for each of these objectives. In the sense, you've written an objective, for example, students will be able to identify types of crystal, or students will be able to calculate various parameters like coordination number. I'm just reading from your responses. Or students will be able to design an application in multiple combinations and compare them. So how will you now assess that the student has actually achieved this objective? So what sort of assessment question will you write? And will this be an exam question or will this be a homework question? These are decisions you have to take. So now your first task is go to the lab, open Moodle, log in, open Moodle, and you'll see an assignment which is called Learning Objective and Assessment. Open it, write down, you can just copy paste the learning objectives that you just now wrote, and write one assessment question for each of these objectives. I think that'll take you about half an hour or so. Then the second important part is actually from yesterday. We had posted a pre-workshop assignment and a survey, and it looks like only about 350, about a third of you have completed the assignment. It's really important that all of you do the assignment before you look at the other, before you attend the other sessions. So once you finish this assignment on learning objectives and assessment, then please go and do the pre-workshop assignment, complete it if you have not already done so. Then go for lunch and we'll meet here at sharp 2 o'clock.